blessings to all upon us. We just ask you to be with us. Look upon us today, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Great old song, Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Ernest Leroy Murphy III passed on January 4, 2023, at the age of 69. Leroy was born on April 1, 1953, in Dearborn, Michigan. He served in the United States Marine Corps. Leroy came to Oregon May 18, 1977, where he met his sweetheart, Rosetta Horner, who lived next door to his first home. They married on December 15, 1979. In December 2022, they celebrated 43 years of marriage. He lovingly called her Rosie. On December 25, 1984, they were blessed by the Lord with the birth of their son, Ryan Joseph Murphy. Despite growing up in unfortunate circumstances, Leroy and Rosetta were determined to raise their only son in a loving home. That's when Leroy and Rosetta became an active part of the United Pentecostal Church, now known as Apostolic Life Center, and remained a part for over 30 years. Leroy received an associate degree in metallurgy at Linben Community College. He started Ernie's Appliance Repair in 1987, where he put his talents for fixing things to work. He later worked at Hewlett-Packard, ATS, DW Fritz, and MEI. His most recent position was at Andrews Cooper in Corvallis as an electrical assembly technician. At all of his jobs, he used his talent for detailed work on many different machines used around the world, including at Nike, Nintendo, and Apple. Many of his co-workers knew him as Ernie. He was well known in the automation industry and was called upon for his experience in the field by electrical engineers. He held a special friendship with one of those engineers named Fidel Delgado. Leroy was always willing to help friends and family whenever they asked, no matter what was going on. He always had a tool or a crafty way to get the job done. He had a love for small tractors and lawnmowers and loved to tinker with small engines. Leroy enjoyed welding and working on many projects around his home. And he loved his dog, Fruit Loop, and his two adopted stray cats, Abraham and Abigail. Leroy was so proud of his new daughter with the marriage of his son to Jacqueline Cleveland in 2014. Becoming a grandpa became his whole world with his three little granddaughters, Betty Rose, age 4, Poppy Quinn, age 3, and Daisy Jo, age 1. And they had him wrapped around their little fingers. They enjoyed riding the lawnmower and taking walks with him, and they always begged to ride home with Grandma and Grandpa. Leroy was always ready to repair a damaged toy or give hugs and cuddles. He was excited about the future addition to his family, with a grandson coming in June 2023. Leroy is survived by his wife Rosetta, his son Ryan, his daughter-in-law Jackie, and his granddaughters, Betty Rose, Poppy Quinn, and Daisy Jo. He was also survived by his siblings, Dion Yurchenko, Peggy Stewart, Michael Murphy, David Murphy, Lori Murphy, Robin Murphy, Kathy Cody, and Michelle Laurel Crum. He was predeceased by his siblings, Patricia Talentino, Joseph Murphy, and Susan Holland. At this time, we have just a few letters that I will be reading on behalf of friends and family. This first letter is from Ticey Tuttle. Leroy, you were taken too soon. We were not ready to lose you, but we know you are safe in heaven. And now you are our angel watching over us. I am happy you got to see Isaac and I fall in love and get married. We are so grateful you got to find out with us that we were having our first baby girl. In the 2 years Isaac got to know you, he looked up to you and thought you were a great guy. We strive to have a beautiful forever marriage like you and Rosetta. As hard as it is to lose you, I will forever cherish the 36 years of memories I got with you. I remember how much you selflessly loved Rosetta, Ryan, Jackie, and the girls. You were always making sure she had everything she needed, helping her and looking for new ways to make things easier for her. You both had a once-in-a-lifetime kind of love, 43 years and counting. You were a great example of how to be a great husband, dad, grandpa, and friend. During my rough teenage years, you would listen to me ramble for hours and made me feel that you understood. You will never know how much that meant to me. I am so blessed that God chose you and Rosetta to be my second dad and mom. I remember working 7 days a week and not having time to mow my lawn. One day, I pulled up and my lawn was beautifully mowed. My first thought was Leroy. You were always so helpful and thoughtful to the people you loved and cared for. Monday, we were talking about your 70th birthday. And I said, April 1st, you will be 70. And you said, and that ain't no joke. Through watching your example, we strive to be better. We are forever blessed and grateful for the precious time we got with you. Heaven has another angel. We love you, Leroy. Next, I have a letter to read from Jackie Murphy, Leroy's daughter-in-law. Dear Dad, where do I start? How about things of the heart? Me and you had similar childhoods, which created us to have very guarded and protected hearts. When I married your son, our hearts collided full speed toward each other. As we tried to figure out how to thaw our hearts enough to let each other in, somewhere along the way, we did. I remember the day you told us that you were not going to try to live and would not consider heart surgery. I was so mad at you because I had let you in my life and now you were crushing my heart. If it hadn't been for the news of your firstborn granddaughter, I wouldn't have had those past 5 years. I thank Betty Rose for saving your life. That moment when we made you hold Betty Rose just after she was born, even though you protested, that was when I watched your heart warm completely and the frostiness completely fall off. Just like in the story of the Grinch, with each grandchild, your heart grew 2 sizes bigger. Somehow, our 2 frosty hearts came to life these past years since we have met. Even though your leaving has left the biggest hole in my heart, I will fill it with the memories of you. Memories like you not wanting me to put a welcome sign in the living room because you were worried it was an invitation for thieves to come in. How you tracked our ship when we went on a cruise and called the Coast Guard because our boat, quote, was going in too many circles, end quote. How you always eat the meat I spend hours cooking the way I cook it and don't immediately put A1 sauce or Montreal seasoning or drown it in sauce like others in the family did. I will always look fondly on my favorite tree and remember how you almost cut it down after you overheard Ryan and I talking about possibly cutting down a totally different tree. You decided to do it on your own as a surprise, and thankfully we came home in time. I was mad at you for absolutely months. After that, Ryan and you were banned from touching another tree with a set of clippers forever. Thank you for the love you showed Mom, how you honored her, respected her, and cared for her. Your son was watching, and I reaped the benefits of the things you taught. Thank you for raising a son that I am so honored to call my husband. He is so like you in so many ways. I love them both dearly. Thank you for being the best grandpa ever, and that doesn't give it justice. You truly were amazing to Betty Rose, Poppy, Daisy, and even to the future grandson. I promise to carry on the memories and never stop sharing your stories to them. They loved you with all their heart, and you basically walked on water in their minds. I will let your legacy live on through them. I miss you and love you, Jackie. And this final letter is from the granddaughters. Since the girls are unable to write a letter, the family wanted to share a couple memories they have shared or love, things they love doing with their grandpa. Last summer, Grandpa would come over and mow our yard with his beloved riding mower. The girls would ride while they work, often falling asleep in his arms. They would cry for Grandpa if ever a neighbor was mowing their yard. They loved sitting with Grandpa on Sunday morning and would yell at him later if he wasn't there. Also, riding home with Grandpa was the only way to travel. He always gave in to the begs and pleads for treats, including dinners at Denny's, mac and cheese at Jack's truck stop, or how Poppy proudly came home and announced she had worms as she carried a bag of gummy worms she got from Grandpa. Rain or shine, Betty Rose could always convince him to take a walk with her and Poppy, and Poppy convinced him to push her in the green car. Here is an exact quote. "Grandpa made the best tea for the tea parties, but it was always really hot. He told us to play really hard until it cooled.
It was the best tea." The favorite story they love to share right now is gingerbread houses with Grandpa and Grandma. Grandpa was loudly crushing candies, and then he decided to melt them in the oven, but he got distracted and burnt the candy. Countless other stories could be told, but there is not enough time. Little Daisy is unable to express much, but she has been learning sign language. And the very first time she did this, it was for her grandpa. At this time, the family would like to present a memorial video.
Don't be mad. If I cry, it just hurts so bad sometimes. 'Cause every day it's sinking in, and I have to say goodbye all over again. You know, I bet it feels good to have the weight of this world off your shoulders now. I'm dreaming of the day when I'm finally there with you. Save a place for me. Save a place for me. I'll be there soon. I'll be there soon. Alone.
never alone. Don't be afraid, I am with you. I called you by name, I have saved you through fire and flood. I am your God, and I will be with you. Trust you, always by my side. I know that it's true. When I feel alone, I can trust you. I'll be still and hear you say, don't be afraid, I am with you. I called you by name, I have saved you through fire and flood. I am your God, and I will be with you. Don't be afraid, I am with you. I called you by name, I have saved you through fire and flood. I am your God, and I will be with you.
Love you, Grandpa.
Love you, Grandpa.
I miss you.
I think most of you know me. If you don't, I'm in this plant. I'm Milton Hollingsworth. I believe if Leroy could see this room, he would be amazed at the people that love him. He was my friend. We got a call when he had his wreck, and Sister Valda called Sister Donna and I home. Asked us to pray for him. And so we got down and we prayed quite a while for Leroy. And later we went to bed, and I got up the next morning, and my wife, she gets up early, 3 o'clock, 1:30, 4 o'clock, whatever. But She got up, and I got up about 6 o'clock that next morning, went out of the bedroom into the kitchen. That first thing I do is pour my coffee, and she had made some banana bread. I cut me a nice piece of banana bread at the end of the counter there, getting ready to go to my recliner. And she stepped, come out of the living room. She had a Kleenex in her hand. She says, "Albert, Leroy didn't make it." I says, "No, okay. Not Leroy." She says, "Yes, they did all they could, and he didn't make it." And I could not pick up my coffee. I couldn't pick up my banana bread. And I sat there, and I had my Kleenex, and I used that, and I wept for Leroy. When I got through, I went in the living room. My wife had her Kleenex. We got to talking about Leroy a little while. He helped us so much in life. And we got to talking about all he'd done for us over the years. And I want to tell you today, 1 week, he was a appliance man. And that's where he helped me, in appliances. 1 week, I'd call him, he'd come. If he wasn't at work, or whatever he's doing, he'd set me a time, he'd let me know, and I'll be there. And that was back in the early days when I was only working on the farm for about $2 an hour. And there wasn't not much money coming in, and we started a Christian school and here at this church. And I'm telling you, friend, I needed Leroy. I mean, that was time. And he would, anytime I called him, he would show up, and most, 90% of the time, he'd call me, want to know what was wrong with my appliance. And I'd tell him, he'd tell me either I could fix it, or he'd about bring the part out to my house and he'd fix it. And I'd try to pay him what I could, but that went on. But one week, on a Monday, I had an appliance go out. Had no problem. On a Tuesday, I come home from work. I had another appliance go out. Well, that's no problem. A couple of appliances. The third day I come home, my hot water tank blew up. My washer and dryer. My hot water tank blew up. I said, "This is crazy." The next day, I come home on Friday evening. I got out in the carport. I got out of my pickup. My wife stepped on the back deck. She says, "Albert, you're not going to believe this." I says, "What, babe?" She says, "Your stove just blew up." I said, "We need Leroy. We got to have Leroy." And did you know, church? I said, "Some of you said, church people." Leroy helped me through every bit of that. And I had no money, hardly in my pocket. But the farm did pay for my hot water tank, and I got it in. But that washer and dryer, see, I would buy my washer and dryer stove stuff used. It was years before I could even buy anything new. But, I mean, prosperity did come. But Leroy helped me through every bit of that. And any time, up to just 3 or 4 years ago, I called him about something over when I lived here in town. And any time I call Leroy, I'm here to tell you. Now, you guys probably didn't get to use him much because I had him at the house all the time. But throughout all of that, Leroy helped me. And as time went, we become good friends. I mean, real good friends. I remember Kurt, Cecilia, these families. We were all close. We were just family. And I see Jerry Easter here, the Easters. And then we were close. We were just a family. And talked a lot. But as time went on, talked to Leroy a lot when he was working on my appliances. I talked to Jesus about it. Talked to God about it. So I talked to him, he'd work. And then if he needed help, I'd help. But most times he'd tell me, I'll take care of him. And so over the years, we talked a lot about God. And as he worked and helped me. And one day, I was telling about Ryan. Ryan was getting older, and I was talking about Ryan, and talking, and I says, Leroy, I'm going to start praying for Ryan for a wife. He needs a wife. So I'm going to start praying for him for a wife. And he says, yeah, do that. So I started praying for Ryan, Bubba. A few years ago, Ryan came up to me, back to the sound system. I walked in, he says, hi, Bubba, how you doing? I says, am I Bubba now? He says, yep. I says, okay, we're Bubbas. We're still Bubbas, ain't we, Ryan? But anyway, I told Ryan, Ryan, I'm going to start praying for your wife. So this went on for quite a while. A girl would show up, and she'd leave. Another girl would show up. I'm telling the truth, Ryan. She'd leave. I don't know if we run her off, or what happened, but she would leave. And so I said, Ryan, I'm going to keep praying. Well, that went on for a while. One day, Ryan told me, Brother Elmer, I'm not getting married. There ain't nobody out there for me. I said, you're dead wrong, Ryan. Do you remember me telling you? You will. I said, Ryan, this world is full of young women. The whole world is full. And you're trying to tell me that you ain't going to get married because there ain't no one out there for you? I said, let me tell you something. There's one out there. And I'm going to pray for that one, that God will send that one, and you guys connect to become man and wife. And David, back me up. Was Rodea behind some of this? Yeah. Ladana, I think it was Ladana, and I don't know if you was involved, but I know Ladana was, because she told me. She says, she told someone that Ryan and Jackie would make a good married couple. And when they told that got to me, I said, whew. I told Ladana, let's pray. Then we started praying, and one day, Ryan, Jackie showed up. I went to his wedding, and I filmed that wedding. He gave them the wedding. Ryan, and I told him, you got a good wife, buddy. You got a fine wife. You got a good Christian wife. And I said, that Jackie, you're going to be a good match. And that lady come, Jackie, you came in this church. You guys got married. We left Phoenix and come home. You guys come home. You came into this church, and you become part of this, involved in this church. Instantly, Sister Jackie become part of this church. We loved her from day one. And they worked together. He worked in the sound system, and he got his business going and everything. And then they start having children, and Betty and Poppy and Daisy, and now the grandson's coming. And I worked in the foyer on Sunday mornings for probably over a year or so back in the foyer. So I greet people when they come in. And so when the grandkids started coming, Leroy and Rosie would bring them in that back door. And so I greet them a lot on Sunday morning. And so when I greet them, I got acquainted with them precious little granddaughters. And Leroy would be packing a bag in one hand and both hands a lot of times.
He come through the door, and he's the first one through the door, and then Rosie and the kids come behind him. And I say, Leroy, what in the world have you got in them sacks? He says, you know what I got. I said, no, I don't, man. He said, that's them babies' kid. That's their stuff. That's their toy stuff. I said, oh, okay. But Leroy loved those babies. And Ryan, you got a wife. You got a precious wife. You got three, four wonderful children, one's coming. And now I'm going to tell you, it's my responsibility and this church's responsibility to make sure that those kids know how great their grandpa was and how loving he was. And the last thing I'm going to say is I talked to Leroy a lot about the Bible, talked to him a lot, but one day from an experience with my wife and her dad, there were some things he was bothered with, and it was probably the last conversation I had with him, and I said, Leroy, we want to go to heaven, don't we? He says, yeah. I said, okay, here's what we got to do. He says, what's that? I says, we got to forgive everything in this life, our past, everything we've ever experienced, everything in life, we have to put it in the past and live for Jesus. And he said, well, I don't have to, forget it. I said, nobody's asking me to forget it. I said, I still remember my past. It's in my mind, it's part of me. God didn't ask me to forget it. He said to forgive it.
Yes.
And you know what? I believe to this day, Leroy heard that. Heard that with all his heart. And I want to tell you something. I'm going to make sure that these grandbabies, my wife and I, we're going to make sure that they know growing up, as long as I'm here and with them, that they knew how great of a grandpa they had in this life. God bless you.
Kids to have kids, and they've had four in 7 years. I hope he's not still praying. I did not know Brother Murphy really well until Brian and Jackie decided to get married, and Jackie is our niece. And I'll never forget how happy he looked on the wedding day that his boy was getting married. And that happy face got happier when those grandkids became around. We've been invited to the baby dedications, and so we go to the house for pizza or food. And I would watch your dad around those kids and your mom. And just so beautiful to watch grandparents get so involved in their kids like that. I thank the Lord. And we're going to sing a song here. The first verse in the chorus is in your program. And Sister Rosetta, I did read your post on Facebook about how you and your husband held hands all the time, and now you would need Jesus to hold your hand. And I was very touched and moved. What a beautiful gesture that you made. So join with me. As I travel through this view, walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ at Calvary. Oh, this would be my prayer, dear Lord. Each day you help me do the best I can, for I need thy light to guide me day. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Saint, oh Jesus, hold my hand. Oh, I
Jesus, hold my hand.
Good that they can be among friends at this point in time. And grateful that God does know how to put us among friends. And in fact, I have long thought about this church. My dad's sister was Rosetta's grandmother. Many of you probably remember Elsie Easter and Andrew Easter. That was my aunt and my uncle. And so one of my brothers and I have talked several times over the last, we do that quite often in fact. He lives in Arkansas still, in fact lives in the house that I grew up in. And we have expressed our appreciation for my aunt Elsie's determination to see some of her family in the church. And we're grateful that the Lord so moved that would happen. And I only actually met Leroy one time. That was in 2013 when we came through and was looking and wound up moving to Idaho later that year. And anyhow, I had breakfast with your pastor, Brother Dennis Johnson. I knew Brother David Johnson's mother in Oklahoma. And she had pastored just about 40 miles from where we started our first church. So it was neat to hear my aunt and uncle talk about your former pastor, Brother David Johnson. And good to meet him. And good to see several of my relatives here today. And of course, celebrating the life of Sister Rosetta's husband. And I don't remember how long I have not been a fan of Facebook, but several years ago somebody shamed me for not taking care of keeping connected, Brother Graves, with some of my other minister friends, and I said, well, maybe I should. And so I got a friend request from Leroy a few years ago, and it was obvious, his post on Facebook, it was obvious he had much interest in helping people, and he did love them grandbabies. And he was proud of his family is Ryan, and I felt like that Sister Rosetta asked me on Sunday if I would participate in this funeral. I already planned to come, and I said I'd be honored to do that. I thought about the scripture in Ecclesiastes. The writer was Solomon, the wise man, probably the wisest according to some at least, even he didn't do everything best. But he was a wise man. He wrote several scripture. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1, he said, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. And as I thought about his passing, so tragic and certainly untimely, 69 years is not enough time, and especially when you're loved by family and provide so much to family. And but I thought about, as I considered his death, I thought, this is going to be a new season. It's going to be a new season, Ryan. It's going to be a new season, Sister Rosetta, and family and friends. It's going to be a brand new season. And I started thinking about our preparations for a new season. Anybody ever get your lawnmower ready for a new season? You spend the time, you think you got it all done, think you got it all together, and you go out to start it when you get ready to mow and the battery's bad. And so your best efforts to prepare, and you wind up one more thing needing done. This is going to be a season that's going to be hard to prepare for, but God will help you. And there are things that we have, in fact, I thought, and I'm not going to take the time to read it all, but Solomon gave us an understanding that there's a time for a lot of stuff. A lot of the time to be born, time to die, and so forth. But he never said anything about a time to quit. So don't quit believing. Don't quit trusting God. Don't quit remembering that it's the Lord that is your friend. And I would say to this church family that there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. In fact, the wise man wrote that as well. Yes. He said there, if a man wants friends, he must show himself friendly. Or has friends, he must show himself friendly. Yes. And there's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. I can tell you that in this season, you need that friend. Amen. Amen. You need that friend. Amen. Now, the pictures, just recently, and some of you probably seen this, but did you see Leroy's? I'm sure it was Leroy's post where he had the drill and he had welded a nut on the trailer tub, on the jack. And I thought, well, that's pretty clever. He was a fix-it man. He was indeed a fix-it man, and Brother Albert has confirmed that. He was a fix-it man. And so there are a lot of things that we can fix. And to this church family, you can fix a lot of lost sorrow, a lot of lost relation. You can fix that by stepping in where Leroy has gone. And family members. And I appreciate Rosetta's aunt, Anna Mae. Some of you may have known her, but some of her children and grandchildren are here. I think that's right. Good to have Renetta. I think that's right. That the way we say it. Here's Renita. Renita right here. Yeah. Good to have her here today. And but it's a great day for us to bind together and be the friend that needs to be. And there's no preparation that this family will make for this season. But the church and the family can pull together and be friends. And all of the thoughts, all of the preparation that you do will never be enough. But God will help you. He is our friend. Yes. Amen. The thing that Jesus said in Matthew, that he would never leave us, that he would never forsake us. And he is trustworthy. You can trust him. He will be there. He is our perpetual comforter. Amen. The oftentimes when someone has passed, family conversations will say, I wonder what, in this case, Leroy would have thought about that in time to come. You'll do something, you'll see something, you'll purchase something, and you'll want to know, what would Leroy have to say? What would he
have said? What would his thoughts have been, right? I mean, I've heard people say, I wonder what Dad would have said. I wonder what Uncle John or whoever would have said. I wonder what they would have thought about this. And given thought to that, I also felt like the Lord impressed on my mind the scripture that I believe if he was here today, I believe if he were here today, we might, he might have some things to say. And the wise man, again, in Ecclesiastes chapter 12, Solomon wrote these words. He said, the preacher sought out to find acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth. The words of the wise are as goads and as nails fastened by the master of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. And further, by these, my son, be admonished of making many books, there's no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God, keep his commandments.
Fear God, keep his commandments. There are a lot of things that we give advice. Somebody told me one time advice is worth about what it costs you. But I was given some advice by a preacher one time. Fear God. Keep his commandments. And I have heard that same advice from people as they recognize that life is not a forever thing on this earth. Fear God and keep his commandments. I believe with all of my heart that if Leroy were here today, he would tell us all, you need to fear God. You need to keep his commandments. It's the whole duty of man. If you don't do anything else, if you don't accomplish anything else, find out what the Word of God says. The last verse of this book of Ecclesiastes
Solomon said, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. It thrilled me when I found out that Leroy had been baptized. He was making decisions about eternity. And today he would have said, fear God, keep his commandments. There's no greater cause, no greater thing. You cannot do a greater thing than to obey the word of God. He is a friend. Amen. He is a friend. This season, you need to remember that he's the friend that sticks closer than a brother. And he will keep you when nothing else will keep you. Amen. And I would encourage you to trust him. Get close to God. Get close to him. He wants to be your friend. God bless you.
Thank you for those beautiful words. Yes. So often at funerals, we discover things we never knew about people in our lives. We all see a different side of people and qualities they have. Others know, but we didn't know about them. And I've known Leroy most of his life. I've really enjoyed everything that's been shared here today. You know, I see he was a better neighbor than I thought he was. You know, he's been a good neighbor to me, but I, you know, my appreciation and for him has grown at this, you know, in the course of this. And thank you for everybody sharing your hearts as you have. He was just a wonderful, good neighbor guy. But I've known Leroy for most of his life, and we got married about the same time. Me and Valda got married like 43 years. And so we've known each other for most of, and I've known most of his life. But at any rate, most of what I saw of Leroy was in connection with the church and the church family. And I could say a lot about the stories that have been told about how helpful he was to members of the church family, just being a good neighbor, how he would show up, fix something, you know, the washers and dryers and all, get the car started, whatever. I think maybe a few of you would share some of those memories here in a little bit. But I just want to take a moment and mention Leroy's faith in God. He did have a very strong faith in God. He was very sincere in his belief in the Bible. And that grew through the years. And I remember the day that he was baptized for the Hampton. I remember that day. He was down front praying right here on the front row pews there on his knees. We had had a good service. And as I walked by him, I felt prompted by the Lord, I feel like, to talk to him about baptism. And, you know, as I recall, the conversation went kind of like this. I just stopped and talked to him there and said, Leroy, you believe the Bible. You believe people should get baptized in Jesus' name, don't you? He looked me right in the eye and said, yes. Because we'd had a lot of Bible studies around the kitchen table, you know, through the years. He knew what the Bible said. And he said, yes. And I just said to him, well, when are you going to get baptized? Why don't we just do it today? He just got up, followed me back to the baptism room. That's a beautiful memory. So thankful. But that's so like Leroy, the way that happened. You know, once he made up his mind about something, he would take action. He would do it, come what may. He would do what he thought was the right thing. And that's really a precious memory to me that day, because I knew he took that step in faith, as Brother Hampton just mentioned. But the most wonderful thing about Leroy, from my perspective, was his decision. He made a decision to value family. And the point has been made. I feel like my remarks are a little redundant, but you'll just have to bear with me because this was Leroy, and these were the thoughts that were on my heart. But it seems that our culture has, in a measure, devalued family since the 60s. Some of you, I actually lived back in the 80s, but I don't feel that old. But family became less important, and personal fulfillment for me was placed on a higher level. But really, the Bible, the wonderful thing about Leroy is that he chose a biblical perspective on that, not necessarily because it was in the Bible, but it was just his choice. And rather than seeking fulfillment and joy in just things and having a hobby or whatever, he sought that and found that in family relationships, like we've already said, and in his friends, circle of friends. And so I just want to honor Leroy for that this afternoon, as others have, kind of along the lines that others have, but especially for choosing to make family and friendships important in his life. He chose there to be there for his family. He was there, Ryan, all your projects, he was there helping you. I know there are a number here that are representative from the United Pentecostal Church of our district. And part of that probably would be because of Ryan's involvement through the years. He's helped at so many of our meetings to run the sound system and set that up. And I think the reason some of you are here is for Ryan, but also because Leroy was behind the scenes many times, loading the boxes and helping make the stuff work. I wonder how many are here that you're just from other churches in the Oregon District, the United Pentecostal Church. So put a number of hands. Brother Johnson, family drove over. I see Brother Johnny there, Brother Gleason, Brother Miranda, different ones. Thank you for being here, Brother Tabor up in Plymouth Falls. Many of you drove a long ways. Thank you. This family is a part of our church, our Oregon District. Just thank you for being here, because Leroy did a lot for our church family, even our district, just working behind the scenes, and we're so thankful for him this morning. But he chose there to be there for his family, his wife, son, his grandchildren, as we have already mentioned, and others close to him. So Leroy understood and chose to live out the biblical perspective on children. And I've been a student of Proverbs for the last many years and much of my life, and a lot of what Solomon wrote about the joy in life has to do with how that's connected with children and grandchildren. Psalm 127 was a psalm that was written by Solomon, and who wrote much of the Proverbs as well. But in Psalm 127:3, Solomon says, "Children are a gift from the Lord. They are a reward from him." And I'm so thankful that Leroy did not see his children, his grandchildren, as an interruption or a bother, but he considered them the most important thing in life. And that's what I just want to celebrate with you this morning especially, is that he made that choice. He was inspiration to all of us the way he loved his son Ryan and his children and Rosetta and Jackie, for that matter. We talked about it many times. My wife and I and this church family, we've tried to do all we could to help kids get started, even having this Christian school for the many years since about the time we got married. And I just want to say, Leroy, I've had many conversations with him because we shared that value for families and children as a gift of God. And so we had a lot of conversations through the years. And I just want to say, Leroy was proud not only of his son and his grandchildren, but he was also proud of all the children, young people that are growing up, starting businesses. Leroy was so proud of our young people building families and just becoming good Christians and building families and so on. He didn't post a lot on Facebook, but he did follow that I saw. Of course, it's hard for me to keep up with that anyway, but I didn't see him posting a lot on Facebook. I don't see a lot of a post, period, but he did follow. I know he followed my mother, Sister Johnson's page pretty regularly, and she would tell me, you know, oh, Leroy put his name on my page here. And a couple days ago, she pointed out something to me that she had posted and reposted in the past. And it reminded her of Leroy. In fact, I think she thought that Leroy had clicked on it at some time in the past. But anyway, reminded her of Leroy and how he loved his son. And I just want to read it this evening. Son, I closed my eyes for but a moment, and suddenly a man stood where a boy used to be. I may not carry you now in my arms, but I will always carry you in my heart. You have given me so many reasons to be proud of the man you have become, but the proudest moment for me is telling others that you are my son. I love you now and forever. Ryan, your dad really loved you. You were blessed, and we see that as a church family. I'm so thankful for that. And he loved all of his family. Rosetta, Jackie, those grandkids. He loved you guys. And, you know, we're just so thankful, you know, for that. This morning, I mean, keep saying this morning, this evening. It seems to me, as others have already said, that these past few years brought a lot of joy into Leroy's life. And he was just so proud of that. And I'm thankful today that God's blessings were on Leroy's life, and that it included the gift of family, this great circle of friends that's here today. Thank you for being him. We enjoyed working with him, just having him a part of our lives. And I hope that this is a reminder, you know, to all of us, that maybe because we have known Leroy, we'll value our family and friends just a little bit more. And it's been a big reminder to me today of how important family is. And I hope we can all just do a little better at seeing our friends and family as the gift from God that they are. And so, God bless you. So glad that we can have a church family. And so thankful for Leroy and his family. Jackie, his daughter-in-law, is going to come right now and sing a song she feels on her heart.
I know your life on earth was trouble, and only I could see
Trend recent years to just take a few memories from those that come to a funeral service, memorial service like this. And the family would like to take a few minutes to do that if someone would just add. There's so much we could say about Leroy. We've looked at different aspects, a little bit of how we saw him and all. He was just he was a good neighbor guy. He was a friend. And I think somebody would like to share something from your heart, share a thought. I think it would be great to do that. We'd like to take time for that right now. So I know some from Leroy's work were at the viewing yesterday, but I didn't really try to look, see who all was here. Did somebody from his work get to be here, you guys? Your hand? I see a lot of hands there. God bless you guys, friends, showing here to show, respect to Leroy. That's great. And I don't know if someone wanted to share something from work. Okay. Let me give you this microphone so we can hear. I know some friends and family are watching from home. We have this online. And so we pass this microphone that these guys can, you guys can hear us.
So I just want to say, right now I'm going to school for welding, and that was really important to my Uncle Leroy, and I'm going to finish it for him. I'm going to do it for him, because I know that it would make him so proud to see me do this. So I just wanted to say that, because I'm going to do this for him, and he gives me all the motivation to do it, so. I just wish that I would have asked him sooner about welding, because I have so much to ask him. But cherish your loved ones, because you never know when they're going to be gone. So,
thank you, Alicia. Yeah. That's great. Kurt, you want to step up here with me? Let's just hand you the mic.
I don't know if I can face the crowd. They're behind my back. Well, I know Leroy through thick and thin, and good and bad. And one thing, Leroy, if you were Leroy's friend, he was on your side. But I have many thousands of memories that go on for hours. But one time, my favorite thing to do is go hunt with my hound dogs, and so I used to try to talk people into doing that with me. And Leroy went. We went out to Buena Vista, at the ferry. It was kind of the winter time, about like now. We walked along and we went toward the river. We turned left or right, and it got foggy. We couldn't tell left or right. For about 4 hours, we went around on a quarter acre. And Leroy was pretty mad. He thought we were never going to find our way off. We were surrounded by water. It looked like we were on an island. And the water was coming up, but it was about maybe 8 feet wide. And he kind of started bawling me out. And I stopped, and looked down, and I could kind of see a little trail where we walked up. If he hadn't started bawling out, each time it might be going around in circles on a little fake island still. And when we got to the truck, he swore, he says, I'm never going Kunan again. And he never did go Kunan. He brought Brian out to the house to go Kunan with us, and we didn't play cards with Sis and Rosetta and them, but he never would go with us. But he did go deer hunting and stuff. He didn't abandon us completely, but coon hunting was out. Like I said, when he made up his mind, it was made up. But I'm glad he was my friend.
Thank you, Kurt, for sharing that. Yeah, I've got, we've got stories. Here. I'm trying to feel like I'm at an auction or something, looking for hands. Blondie.
Rosetta and I have been like connected at hips forever. And so it made Leroy must be close because I had to love him, love her. And he did so many things for me. I can't say them all, but the last thing that I really remember is when in the hospital, Rosetta said, when I get off work, do you think of things that you need and I'll bring it to you? So I called and Leroy answered and I said, I just need a hairbrush right now because this hospital is horrible. And I didn't have much hair. I needed something to brush it that I felt comfortable with, and so it wasn't long. He showed up at the hospital with a hairbrush for me. Made sure I had one. He just always made sure, if somebody asked for something, he would do it.
Together and helped each other out over the years. And when Ryan and Jackie got married, we drove down to Phoenix, and I just bought a brand new truck and I was a lot of debt. And I swore I wouldn't put the trailer hitch on it. I wouldn't tow anything with it. But then Ryan and Jackie had a U-Haul trailer that they were going to tow all the way back. In their honeymoon, tow it all over the place. So I volunteered to tow it back for them. I went and bought a ball and a light kit to hook up the lights for it. And that really made an impression on him. And he says, you know what? That's something I didn't expect out of you. And he says, I love you. And that's something I didn't expect out of him. He was a loving husband, loving father, grandpa. And he will be missed.
Yes.
And if there's anything either of you need, let me know. If I can do it out there.
I just wonder if somebody from his workplace would want to say a word here. We didn't see that side of him on the job much. We just saw him around here. Somebody, okay, thanks.
Thank you. My name is Brent Gibson. I'm an industry group. I have the privilege to work with Ernie. We know him as Ernie at work. And he always had a bright attitude, good spirit. And there's a story here, in the office at the shop, there's a lifeblood, it's coffee. And we go through a lot of coffee, and it's amazing that coffee grinders don't hold up the way you'd expect. And just earlier, the week of his accident, we had another problem with the coffee grinder. Guess what? Ernie's there, cleaning it out, getting it going again. So we're surely going to miss him in all aspects of work. And what are we going to do when the coffee grinder breaks next time? No, he was great.
Thank you. Thank you. Excuse me. Oh, sorry, man.
My name is Blake Walker, and Ernie actually worked for me, so I was his manager. So I was going to tell the story, right, got to what actually happened last week on Tuesday. The funnier part is it was our CEO that was trying to fix it. And I walked by Ernie, and I said, coffee grinder's jammed, can you go fix it again? And he says, I'll get to it. And I walked by a few minutes later, and he was there. Coffee grinder's a part on the counter. Got it all cleaned out, working again. And it was one of those things I'm going to miss. He was Mr. Fitzhead. I could throw anything at him, and he would go do it. And he would do it with a smile. I'm truly going to miss that. So, nice to see everybody here. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I know there's more things that we, a lot of stories maybe we could share around the table. There is a meal prepared for all anyone, you know, can stay. It's just right downstairs after this. But we want to end this with a prayer. My father loved me, Leroy, very much. And am I forgetting something? Ryan? Sure, we've got time for that. After Ryan shares his hearts, then we'll have Dad pray.
Well, sorry, I just wanted to thank everyone who's helped my mom through all this, publicly thank them. I've been pretty lost, I'll be honest. I just go to the crash site, and I go look at his car, and I try to figure it out, and I can't. And then I feel bad that I'm not next to my mom and Cecilia and all the Wilcoxes and everyone's been so close to my mom, and her sister came out, and one of my good friends, David, came out, and all the way from Ohio, he lived in, I told him, I was like, no, I don't tell him not to come out, but he couldn't wait. He had to just buy a plane ticket. And I just wanted to publicly thank everyone who's been so kind to us. And just thank you. Thank you so much. I was going to try to do it without crying, but I apologize.
Thank you, Ryan. It's a wonderful thing to have a circle of friends, for a church family and a family. So thank you, Ryan. Dad, you loved Leroy very much, and I know you were much in prayer for the last, you know, the day of the accident. We just want you to come and just pray and kind of conclude the service here.
Our Father, our dear Heavenly Father, who loves us and cares for us, we want to thank you for the blessings of this day, the riches of your grace and your virtues. Thank you for what we have heard today, God. But we are hurt. And we come to you asking you, dear Father in heaven, to be with us in a special way in the days ahead. Give us strength to press on. Grant to us another measure of what we have heard out of Leroy's heart today, to love one another. And to give freely. You told us to love others. labor as our son. That was a big challenge. But we thank you for what we've heard. And we're asking you to give us a sensitivity to your close presence in the days ahead as we seek to handle this loss. And we believe that you are our Heavenly Father who loves us and who understands the future and who knows what's ahead. We're praying now, God, that you will give us the presence of mind that we need, the understanding that we need today according to your divine truths. Guide us, be with us, direct us, God, we pray, from this day on, and grant to us to live according to your word and your plan for mankind on earth and for the church of the living God. We love you and thank you and ask you to bless and go with us now in Jesus' name.
There's not enough room downstairs for all of us to sit down at once, so let's just move through, you know, as we can, our family, and it's probably for about maybe 100 there at a time, and I think we can work with it, but it's right downstairs at the conclusion. Barb, thanks for your help with all this.
I want to thank you for being here. We are going to take just a moment, open the casket. So if you would like to say a final goodbye, we'll have that opportunity. Otherwise, you can head down to the reception area, just around the corner and down the stairs. We'll ask that you come from this side, come through here, and then go out this way, okay? Don't feel you have to, but if you'd like to, we'll just make it and just be a quick being able to say goodbye again. So we're going to take a moment right now and open the casket for you. Otherwise, you're welcome to head down to the reception.